Well, we are continuing on in this series, addressing barriers. Barriers to faith, different kinds of barriers that we might face. We started some weeks ago at the beginning of the summer talking about intellectual barriers to faith, and we looked at some of those things that we kind of bump into with our minds, and some people that are trying to maybe make their way to Jesus for the first time, they're trying to reason their way there and figure out their way there, and they kind of bump into some barriers and say, well, I'm not sure if I can cross that and get to that place of faith in Jesus. Or people who walk with Jesus and know him and love him, and in that walk and in that journey along the way, bump into things and just say, boy, this kind of gets in the way of me going forward, of thriving in my faith. The last couple of weeks, we've been talking about practical barriers to faith. Just those daily realities that we face in the world we live in that might become an obstacle. And we're trying to look at those and move beyond those. So we talked 2 weeks ago about, what about if I don't have all the answers? What if I don't understand certain things about the Christian faith? What if there's still issues in me and my life that aren't quite right? And there's some people, as they're walking towards Jesus, trying to understand who he is, they bump into this barrier of saying, you know what? I still have questions. And I still have issues in my life that if there is this loving, great, powerful God, he probably wouldn't be happy with the issues in my life. So I'll stay here on this side of the barrier and I won't come to faith in Jesus. We talked about the fact that really, anyone who knows and loves Jesus, there's still questions, there's still issues. The question is, do we know enough to get beyond those barriers and keep pressing forward? I've been a pastor for almost 30 years. I've been a Christian for 35 years. And I still have questions. I still have things I don't understand. There's still stuff in my life that isn't right with God that I have to address, I have to deal with. And yet I know enough to move past those barriers and to walk with Jesus. And then last week, we had Jeff Mannion visiting, and he talked about the barrier of stuff, of money, of material things, and sometimes a love of things or a desire to acquire things or being possessed by things instead of possessing them and using them for the Lord. It can get in the way of us coming to know Jesus. Jesus said a lot about that, about stuff getting in the way. You can't serve two masters. You have to make some decisions. But also when you know Jesus, stuff can kind of take over our lives. So we're talking about these practical barriers, and can we move beyond them? Now today's barrier is a really challenging one, and it's one that will hit home for every single person here, because we're talking about our sexuality. We're talking about sometimes we run into a barrier of how we see ourselves as men and women, as sexual people in our world, and how God sees sexuality. So our message is entitled, How Can I Relate to a God Who Sets Sexual Boundaries and Guidelines That Just Don't Fit Into Today's World? Now, how do we relate with a God who is kind of old-fashioned, you know? God's view of things hasn't changed a lot because the Bible hasn't changed. So how do I come near that God who may see sexuality differently than I do? Or how do, if I'm a Christian, how do I keep walking with God? And I think ultimately what we have to do is we have to address the fact that God is the one who designed our sexuality, that God made us. And maybe God understands sexuality better than we do. But here's something we have to acknowledge as we talk about this, that this is a deeply personal topic. It goes to the core of who we are. It's one that we feel very strongly about. And so I want to ask that you would consider doing at least two things today. First, I'm going to ask that you would stay. Physically stay through the whole message. I may share some things from the Bible that you don't agree with. I may share a perspective that you maybe isn't your perspective. But will you commit to actually physically staying present through the whole message? So often we talk about, well, you know, we're a very open-minded world, and I'm very open-minded to anybody who has a perspective that's just like mine. And that's, you know, we talk about being so open-minded, but the reality is when somebody disagrees with us, we can become kind of bristly. I'm going to ask you today, would you stay physically? But second, would you stay mentally? Will you commit to keep your mind engaged for the next 33, 34 minutes? Will you listen and be open? And we may get to the end of the time, you might say, I disagree with you. I disagree with what the Bible says. But I want you to hear. And I want you to have a perspective that's informed. And I want you to understand where Shoreline comes from on this topic, because we are a biblical Christian church. And so I want to pray and ask that God would speak to us right where we are, because I understand that this is deeply personal and also for many, many people, deeply painful. There's a lot of pain around our sexuality. Because of crossing boundaries, because other people have crossed boundaries and impacted us, because we made decisions that we wish we hadn't made, because people we love and care about are struggling with this area of their lives. So let's pray and ask that God would meet us right where we are with whatever our challenges, wherever we are, whatever our perspective is, and that God would speak to us. Let's pray together. God, I thank you for Shoreline Church. Those gathered here in the worship center, those gathered in our different venues, those gathered in gatherings around the world through our military. I thank you that as a congregation, we address tough challenges. We look at your word and what it says about a lot of things, and we, Lord, we really seek to align our lives rather than telling you what we think you should be. We seek to align our lives with what you say is true. And so speak to us and teach us today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in our time together, what I want to talk about is I want to talk about six biblical truths about sexuality, six of the things that the Bible teaches that the Christian church has believed for 2,000 years, that the Christian church believes really broadly all around the world today. And I want to look at those kind of core biblical truths about sexuality. Then we're going to look at six modern myths about sexuality. Biblical truths, modern myths. So here's the first biblical truth. God invented male and female, and he declared it very good. If you have your Bibles, turn to Genesis chapter 1. Really easy to find. If you're new with the Bible, just start at the beginning and turn a couple pages. You'll find it. Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 27 and 28, and then also verse 31. Genesis 1, beginning in verse 27. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. And then jump with me down to verse 31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. I want you to notice a couple of things here as we understand that God invented male and female. The fact that we're male and female is no surprise to God. It's his design. Your maleness or your femaleness is a gift from God. It's part of his plan, his design, and he looks at you as a man. Men, God looks at you as a man and says, that's very good. I designed you like that. Women, he looks at you as a woman and says, God says, that's very good, part of my design. And then within this passage as well, verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Now, the reason there were signs at the doors and little warnings if you had kids with you is I'm not going to get graphic and go weird about anything, but I want to be able to talk openly about what we're talking about in the Bible here. Here in verse 28, when God says, be fruitful and increase in number, God knew what he meant by that. He was saying, have babies. God was saying, in this relationship that I've designed, a man and a woman, in this covenant that I put together of marriage, he says, I want you to actually be fruitful and multiply. And God knew that didn't come by shaking hands. Following me? Okay. Some of you, God said, with a man and a woman, have sexual intimacy, sexual intercourse, and then have children. And God says, I like this plan. This is a good gift. We need to understand at the beginning that nothing about our sexuality surprises God. The fact that we're men and women is a gift from God. And that God put a man and a woman together and said, be fruitful and multiply, make babies, is part of God's very good plan. Sexuality is part of God's design from the beginning, and it's a good gift. We have to start there. Because some people think that the church believes, or Christians believe, that sex is a bad thing, and we don't. The Bible teaches it's a good gift made by him. It's just that within that gifting, there's also boundaries. First thing, God invented male and female and declared it is very good. Biblical truth about sexuality, number two. From the beginning, God designed men for women and women for men. There's this complementary deal that God does, bringing men and women together. Look with me at Genesis chapter 2, beginning in verse 20. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took out one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. And the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man. And he brought her to the man. And the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, that's the covenant of marriage, and they become one flesh, that's sexual intimacy. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Part of God's plan and his design is for a man and a woman to be connected, to fit together emotionally, spiritually, relationally, sexually. That there's this connection that God makes between a man and a woman and a woman and a man. And it's part of God's design. And I believe that part of that design is actually that God makes men better because of women in their life. And God makes women better because of men in their life. So because of my mother, because of my three sisters, because of my wife, there's a way that I see the world that is different if I didn't have those women in my life, and particularly for me being married to Sherry. I believe I'm a better version of who God wants me to be because God's put Sherry in my life. And when we left our parents and we were united in marriage and we cleaved together intimately, sexually, when we become what God wants us to be as a couple and as a family, I become a better person and more of who God wants me to be because I have Sherry in my life. And I have a suspicion that she's become a better person because of me. She's smiling. I'm going to take that smile as an emphatic yes. But there's a design that God has made in the beginning, in the core of creation. And there's a way that he grows us and makes us more who he wants us to be as men and women. Third truth from the Bible about our sexuality. God wants us to reserve sexual intimacy and enjoyment for within the covenant relationship of marriage. Now, this is where you start getting pushback from some. This is where some may want to click off. But I'm trying to walk you through what the Bible teaches about our sexuality. God's perspective, since he's the inventor and the creator of all of this. God wants us to reserve sexual intimacy and enjoyment for within the covenant relationship of marriage. So when God brings a man and a woman together in this covenant relationship, that sexual expression is a wonderful gift. But outside of that, it's not what God's design is for us. And we have to listen to God and hear what God has to say about this. I've heard this said. Too many single people are having too much sex. And not enough married people are having enough sex. Last service, I got like 4 or 5 amens on that one. No, I didn't. People say, we're talking about sex. We're just going to be quiet and listen. But God's design is a design for intimacy within these boundaries. And so look with me at Proverbs chapter 5. Proverbs chapter 5, 6, and 7 are actually all about our sexuality, about boundaries, about God's design and God's plan. So in Proverbs chapter 5, we're going to start in verse 15. And the imagery here, it's veiled at first, but you'll figure it out pretty quickly. The imagery of water is a picture of sexual intimacy. So when the writer says, drink water from your own cistern, running water from your own well, it's talking about a married couple expressing themselves intimately sexually as a couple. The water image gets less and less vague and more clear as we go along. So let's look at this. Proverbs 5, beginning of verse 15. Again, a picture of sexuality, this picture of water. Drink water from your own cistern, running water from your own well. Should your springs overflow in the streets, your streams of water in the public squares. Your sexuality isn't to be expressed out there just with anybody, anywhere, though our world kind of lives that way. God says that's not the design. It shouldn't be. Let them be yours alone, never to be shared with strangers. That's the exclusivity of the marriage relationship. Verse 9, now it gets a little more clear. May your fountain be blessed, and may you rejoice in the wife of your youth. Shall I explain that one? You're all uncomfortable, aren't you? You're all thinking, what's he going to say? That's because you know me, and I say whatever comes to my mind. May your fountain be blessed. May you rejoice in the wife of your... This is an invitation, an exhortation within the marriage relationship to a sexual expression. It continues to get more detailed. Verse 19, a loving doe, a graceful deer. May her breasts satisfy you always. May you ever be intoxicated with her love. Now we're not talking water anymore. It's just talking about sexual intimacy within marriage. Why, my son, be intoxicated with another man's wife? Why embrace the bosom of a wayward woman? And then verse 21 kind of sums it up. For your ways are in full view of the Lord, and he examines all your paths. God says, I made sexuality, I made male and female, sexual intimacy. It's a good gift, but I also gave boundaries. And so here, God wants us to reserve sexual intimacy and enjoyment for within the covenant relationship of marriage. And so it's saying, don't scatter your waters out in the streets. Don't, you know, our world kind of says, you know, anything, anywhere with anyone, as long as you're consenting, have fun. And God says, that's not my design. That's not my plan. Well, why is that? Well, the next truth. Sexual intimacy and consummation outside of the covenant relationship of marriage is not God's design, and ultimately it's hurtful to us, to who God wants us to be. And some people say, well, it doesn't seem hurtful to me. It seems fine. But God says, it is. I designed you. I know how you function best. And my design is the best design for this. And so God wants us to experience the best lives, and sexual intimacy and consummation outside the covenant of relationship of marriage is not God's design. It's hurtful. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, The Apostle Paul here is dealing specifically with sexuality, and he's talking to a culture and a people who are doing about anything they want with anybody, anywhere, which is kind of where our culture is going, where a lot of our world is today. So this doesn't seem very far away. And the quote that the Apostle Paul quotes at first, he's actually using a line that was used in the city of Corinth and other cities in the ancient world with people who were doing anything they wanted sexually and saying, I can do anything I want. My body, I'm a grown-up, I can do what I want, kind of a mindset. So look at how he starts verse 12 of 1 Corinthians chapter 5. He quotes the people of the city of Corinth. They're saying, I have the right to do anything. They're talking specifically about their sexuality. I have the right to do anything. People that say that today still. He says, you say. But then Paul says, but not everything is beneficial. Then he quotes them again. You're saying, I have the right to do anything. And Paul says, but I will not be mastered by anything. For a lot of people, sex has mastered them. They're not masters of sex. They're mastered by sex. And they're addicted to pornography. And they're addicted to sexuality. And their life has gone upside down because their sexuality has gone out of control. And Paul says, I will not be mastered by anything. You say, this is another one of their quotes in the city of Corinth, in the ancient world, food for the stomach and the stomach for food. Meaning I can eat whatever I want. I can do whatever I want. I can have sex with anyone I want. I can eat whatever I want. This is the thinking of the day back then. But Paul says, but the body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. God cares about our bodies and what we do with them. Verse 14, by his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one in her with body? For it is said, the two shall become one flesh. But whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. The Apostle Paul is saying, understand something. There's a connection that happens in your body, in your soul, when you connect with another person. But ultimately, we're supposed to be connected with God. He cares about your body. He cares about all that you are. It's not like God gets you 1 hour a week when you come to church and then pretty much the rest of the week is your own thing. If you come to God through faith in Jesus, you belong to him and he dwells in you. And God cares about that. And so he's saying, listen, I don't want you to live a life that is a life of pain and of brokenness. And there's so much pain and brokenness when it comes to sexuality. I've been reading 3 or 4 different books on sexuality, and I've listed a lot of them. If you go to the Shoreline website under resources, sermon resources, you'll find about 7 different books listed there. You click, it's a live link. It takes you right to Amazon. You can look at the book, get a review of the book. But I've been reading a number of these books and just grappling with this. And one of the authors, you know, no picture is perfect, no illustration is perfect, but they use the picture of a Post-it note. They talk about how, you know, when you use a Post-it note for the first time, you kind of peel it off the little Post-it square of notes, and you post it somewhere, it sticks really well. But have you ever used it most? And then you kind of go, well, then you want to write another note, you pull it off, and then you stick it back up, and it sticks okay. And then after 4 or 5 times, after 8 or 9 times, it kind of just sort of falls off. It doesn't work anymore. There's this affixing, bonding power that's kind of gone. And this author talked about how for us in our sexuality, if we're just out trying to bond with everybody, if we have no boundaries, what happens is we don't end up bonding with anybody. The ability, that design that God has for a man and a woman to bond together in the covenant of marriage and to have beautiful, God-honoring sexual expression, that connectedness is no longer there. And it's just kind of going from person to person to person to person till the ability to even bond emotionally and even in a meaningful way physically kind of goes away. And this author was grappling with that, saying, ultimately, when we're living with our sexuality outside of God's design, it hurts us. We miss what it's all about, and that breaks the heart of God because he wants what's best for his children. Sexual intimacy and consummation outside the covenant relationship of marriage is not God's design, and it's hurtful. Now, within that, some of you are maybe thinking, well, what do you mean? Be specific. When you say sexuality outside the boundaries of what God has designed for us, what are you talking about? I want to be very specific, and I want to walk. Each of these things I'm going to mention in about 15 seconds could be a whole sermon. I've got all these books listed on our website because if you want to dig into any of these topics, we have books on all of them. And so you can kind of go to the website and you can find a list of biblical passages and study, and you can dig into that more. But I want to just clarify, what are some examples of sexual expression that's outside of God's design and best plan for our lives according to the Bible? And you can go deeper if you look at the list of resources. So I'll walk through some of these. First, when a married person has sexual relations with someone other than their spouse, if you're a married person in that relationship, you've been united together, if you have sexual relations outside that marriage covenant, God says, that's not my design. The biblical term for that is adultery. And God says, that's not my design for you. When you're in that covenant of marriage, stay there in that relationship and reserve yourself sexually within that relationship. A second thing, when a married person consistently refrains from sexual relations with their spouse. That's not God's design. If you're in the covenant of marriage, and if there's not a physical reason, or if there's not some kind of a emotional process you're walking through, but you're in a healthy place as a couple, the Bible says you should express yourself sexually, and it's actually wrong not to. That's supposed to be part of your relationship. Here's the third thing. When two people of the same gender have sexual relations with each other, the term for that is homosexuality. And the Bible would say that's not God's design. It's not his plan, how he wants us to bond to be together in relationship. The next one, when a person has sexual relations with both men and women, that's called bisexuality. It's a growing trend in our culture, a growing trend among young people on college campuses of exploring. Because the idea is, like they said back in Corinth, I can do anything I want. And if it brings me pleasure, how could it be wrong? But God says, that's not my design. That's not my plan. When two unmarried people have sexual relations with each other, that's called fornication. So somebody said, what you're saying, if we're two mature adults and we live together and we share the bills and we share the same bed and we're sexually involved with each other, that's not right? That's not God's plan? It's not. If you want God's design and plan for you, God says it's within the covenant of marriage between a man and a woman. And if you're living outside of that, that's not God's design. And then also having sexual relations with multiple people. You say, we shouldn't have to say that. In our world today, we do have to say that. And with the advent of the accessibility of all that's in the media and all that's in the internet, the picture of the world is pretty much anything you want to do that you would enjoy, go for it. And God says, I love you, and I've made you, and I've designed you, and I know how you work best, and I know how you will bond and find the best life. And so the question is, will we listen to God, or will we listen to what we feel or what culture says? Biblical truth number 5. Sexual sin is more than just physical actions. It can be a condition of our heart. If you have your Bibles, turn to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 27. Jesus is teaching, and he's talking about sexual boundaries, but he goes beyond just the physical actions to the condition of our hearts. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 5, beginning in verse 27. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. That's actually from the Ten Commandments. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out, throw it away. He's saying, cut off the source of that temptation. Gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Now, Jesus isn't saying, rip your eye out, cut your hand off. What he's saying is that this temptation to sexual sin in our hearts and in our minds is serious stuff. So cut off the source of what's feeding that into your heart and feeding that into your mind. Jesus says, it's not just what we do with our bodies. It's what we do in our hearts and in our minds. And our culture right now has pretty much sanctioned and approved pornography as just normal. And a lot of people have bought into that. And Gary Thomas, who spoke for us a few weeks back, who was a guest speaker and talked about parenting, he said, I love this line. He said, it's almost not a fair fight anymore. Actually, he said, it's not a fair fight anymore, that pornography is so available to this young generation and to us. It's so there. It's so in your face. Stuff that used to be called pornography is now your regular made-for-television shows on Showtime and HBO. And they're all being pushed for more sex, more violence, more profanity. This is true. They're being pushed for more because it seems like it's insatiable and people want more. For men, a lot of that is visual. For women, I need to say this. For women, a lot of it is emotional connection through books. Some women go after the visual thing and that connects them, but there's a lot of women who read romance books that are more pornographic and more graphic than most videos that are out there. And they'd be offended if their husband or a man they knew was watching pornography, but they're reading. There's a whole sections now in Barnes & Noble on paranormal romance. I know this because the last time I was in one of those stores, I always look at what's new, and there's book after book. I took them off the shelf, and I read the back, and I'm like, this is hardcore pornography with aliens or with vampires. I'm not kidding. Don't go look, but it's out there, okay? It's out there. And so it's not just what we see with our eyes. It's what happens in our hearts. So for men and women, whatever that attraction is that draws you to those things that promise so much and give nothing, that isn't a real person in front of you in a real covenant relationship, stay away from it. And that leads us to the last thing, the last of the biblical truths. There's more we could talk about. The last I want to think about this morning, number 6, living outside of God's boundaries for sexual expression is sin, and we should run from all sin. God calls us to sexual purity and holiness that honors him and blesses our lives. That's what God wants. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, it continues on after the part we read a moment ago in verse 18. The Apostle Paul says, flee from sexual immorality. Run, flee, get away. Like Jesus said, cut it off, get rid of the source. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Now listen to this. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you? If you're a follower of Jesus, the Spirit of God lives in you, whom you've received from God. You are not your own. I'm my own. I can do whatever I want. The Bible says you're not your own. You were bought with a price. That's the death of Jesus on the cross. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies and honor God with your hearts and honor God with your minds. Flee, run from sexual immorality. There's all kinds of things that we can talk about that the Bible says about us as sexual people. I want to talk about six modern myths about sexuality. Six things that are common in our thinking in our world that I think are inaccurate and wrong. And I want you to hear what I believe is the truth. Here's the first modern myth about sexuality. Number one, if you hold to a traditional biblical position on sexuality, you are closed-minded, mean-spirited, and hate-filled. There are people who will say, if you hold the position I've just talked about today, the traditional biblical position on sexuality, that you are a hater, you are mean-spirited, you're unloving. Here's the truth. We can hold a radically different perspective on sexuality and be caring, loving, and friends. We can get along. We can talk with each other. We can think together. We can grab. We can disagree and still get along. All of the areas I've talked about, I know people in Shoreline Church who struggle with every one of the sins that I talked about, every one of the areas where people work and live outside of God's boundaries. I know people that are part of this church that struggle with, not one person that struggles with all of them, but I know individuals who struggle with one of them or more. I know people that are part of this church that live together, that aren't married, and understand that that's not God's design. And I want to tell you something as a pastor. I love them. I care deeply about them, and I'm so glad they're part of Shoreline. It doesn't mean that I say, okay, I think that the way they're living is right. I don't think it's God's best plan for them, but they're part of this church and they should be part of this church and they're loved here. I know people that are part of this church that are in same-sex relationships and I love them and I care about them. I know people in this church that battle and struggle with pornography on a deep level and sexual addictions and I love them and I care about them. It is a myth to say that if you hold a traditional Christian position about sexuality, that somehow you are a hater of everyone who disagrees with you. Some people are hateful, but most Christians are not. And so we need to hear the truth on that. And then the second myth is this. If you don't accept someone just as they are and affirm their choice and lifestyle, you can't love them. Have you heard that? If you don't accept me just the way I am, then you don't love me. Anyone here who's raised children knows that isn't true. Because there's times when your kids behave in a way that you don't agree with, but you still love them. You don't hate them. You love them deeply. You just disagree. And so here's the truth. All of us have people in our lives who we disagree with, and we still love them. My wife and I don't always agree. There's been two or three times in our 30 years of marriage that we've disagreed 2,000 or 3,000 times, right? But we love each other. When someone says, if you don't agree with how I see the world, how I see myself sexually, that you can't love me, I just want to say, that's not true. And let's not, the media does that and the polemical, conflictual, we have to all agree or we can't even speak to each other thing, but let's not be that way here within the church. Let's be able to say, you know what? There's things I disagree with all kinds of. I don't know if there's anybody in my life that I know that I agree with everything. I don't even agree with myself sometimes, right? But we can love each other while we disagree. Modern myth number three, and we have to hear this. This is a myth. God hates people who struggle with their sexuality and sexual sin. You talk about a barrier. If you look and say, boy, if I struggle with my sexuality in any of these different ways we talked about, God hates me. That is not the truth. Here's the truth. God loves us in all of our sins and struggles so much that he gave his own life for us. God does not hate people struggling with sin. God loves people struggling with sin. If you're a note taker, write down Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Romans 5:8. It says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's the love of God. Whatever that sin is, that God sent his only son to die on the cross to save us, to wash us clean, to invite us back to himself in the midst of our sin. If someone's trying to tell you that God hates you because you struggle with sin or sexual sin, the truth of the matter is, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son. Now, he sent his son that we might put faith in him, follow him, be transformed by his grace. But the initiation and the initial working of God's love came while we were in the midst of our sins and we could do nothing to fix ourselves. So it's a myth to say that God hates people who struggle with their sexuality and their sin. Myth number four, our desires, if they come naturally, should be acted on and lived out. That's a myth. Our desires, if they come, but it comes naturally to me, then we should act on that. Here's the truth. We don't believe this in any other area of life. Why apply this to an area as intense as our sexuality? Do you really believe it's best to live your life by just doing everything that comes naturally to you? Here's the reality for me. Almost everything that comes natural to me is wrong. I'm your pastor. Can I tell you that? Food. I would eat every Mexican dish you put in front of me, I mean all of them, right now, without restraint, naturally. I love sweets. I love candy. I love Slurpees. I love malted milk balls. I love, if it's bad for me, I love it. And I don't even try. It comes naturally. My life is not doing what comes naturally. My life is learning to not do what comes naturally. If you're a parent, of course what you say to your children is just do everything that comes naturally and they turn out wonderful, right? Just do whatever comes. So you have a child that comes out of the womb with a temper. I mean, they just come out screaming and they don't stop for like 70 years. They just come out and they feel passionately and so what do you say to that child? Well, Billy, I know your sister's bothering you. And I know what you feel right now naturally is you want to punch her as hard as you can. So do what comes naturally. Is that what anyone tells their child? What do you say? Don't do what comes naturally. Because sometimes what comes naturally is actually wrong. The Bible talks about a sin nature because of fall and sin. Much of what we do naturally is the wrong thing. I know a lot of married men who feel temptation and sexual attraction to other women besides their wife. What do I say to them? Do what comes naturally? No. I say do what comes supernaturally. So much of what comes naturally for us is not the right things. And so the myth is that our desires, if they come naturally, should be acted on and lived out. The truth is, we don't believe this in any other area of life. Why apply this to something as intense as our sexual? Just do whatever comes naturally. If every single person did whatever came naturally in terms of their sexual desires, well, there's people that do that, and some of them are in jail right now. There's things that people, they say, well, I don't want to feel this way. I felt like this since I was a child. It comes naturally. We don't always do what comes naturally. And that leads to number five, modern myths about sexuality. You can't change what comes naturally. And it's wrong to even try. And there's those that would say, if something comes naturally, you can never change it. I hope that's not true. Because there's so much that comes naturally for us that comes out of our sin nature and that isn't right. So don't even try. Does it come naturally to exercise or to lay on a couch and eat Cheetos? And so you say, I need the supernatural power of God to overcome what comes naturally. So here's the truth. We all have behaviors, patterns, dispositions, and orientations that come naturally. That from our oldest memories, it was there. I'm selfish by nature. I don't like to share. Well, then be selfish. No, Jesus says, no, get beyond that and learn to be generous. We all have behaviors, patterns, dispositions, and orientations that come naturally, but we seek to change them. Followers of Jesus seek to live in the supernatural power of Jesus and overcome natural inclinations all the time, in all kinds of areas. When temptations come of all sorts, we say, God, can you give me the supernatural power that comes by your Spirit living in me, that I won't do what comes naturally, but I will do what comes supernaturally. And that may be a prayer you have to pray every day for the rest of your life. I know Christian leaders, godly men, who pastor churches, who love their wives, who will say, I feel tempted to engage in pornography. I don't try to. It comes naturally. As a pastor and a friend, I say to them, what can we do to help you stay accountable to day by day by day, not take the bait, not get hooked into that, not go into that? I know godly men who love their wives, but they feel tempted to be involved with other women. And they're not trying to feel that way. They hate the way they hate that they feel that way. But it's there, and it comes pretty naturally. In the supernatural power of Jesus, day by day by day, they're saying no to temptation. I know young people, and this is true. This is not, I'm not just making this. I know young people who are engaged and dating, or you know, they're dating, they're engaged, they love the person that they're gonna marry, somebody that they're with, and they don't get involved sexually. Really? There's actually people, this is true. It's a possibility. People say, shouldn't even talk about it anymore. No one's gonna listen. I know people who are engaged and getting ready to get married, or they know they're going to get engaged someday, and they're not involved sexually with that person, but it's a temptation every single time they're with that person. And they're fighting it day by day and moment by moment. For Sherry and I, when we were engaged, there were hundreds of reasons I could think of why we should be sexually involved. And only one I could think of that we shouldn't be. And that was that God said, that's not what I have for you. My boundary is to stay outside of that. So I had to run away from her sometimes. She would chase me. She's Dutch. She's strong. She's fast. But I'm fast too. Praise the Lord. No. But the reality is, if we had done what came naturally, we wouldn't have the same joy we have now. But we battled against it. It's true in so many areas of life. Are there times when it comes to our sexuality, something as supercharged as that maybe what we're wanting, what we're desiring, what seems natural is not God's design. In the supernatural power of Jesus, we battle in all these different areas. And then one more modern-day myth, and I want you to hear this. This is so important. The church is no place for people struggling with sexual sin. That's why I wanted to ask people to not leave, to hear this. Here's the truth. The church is the best place for people struggling with any and every kind of sin. This is the best place to be if you want to battle sin. Now, you might say, I disagree with what you've said. I disagree with what the Bible says. That's up to you. But I'm telling you, in terms of this church and Bible-believing churches, and the churches around this peninsula, I meet with the other pastors of all the growing larger churches in the Monterey Peninsula, all of the pastors would say, the way we view sexuality is exactly the same as where Shoreline is. Monterey Church, Calvary Church, Cypress Church, Carmel Press. I meet with all these pastors. We've talked about this. We all have the same view on this because we all work from the same book. We work from the Bible. And so are people welcome in the church if they're grappling with sin? Here's the truth. If every person who comes to Shoreline in this worship center, in our venues, internationally, who follows us online, if every person said, I'm not going to come to church, I'm not going to engage anymore, if I'm struggling with some kind of temptation or sin, I'd be alone. No, I wouldn't be here, right? Nobody would be here. The beauty of it is that we walk together. We learn together. We may disagree on things. That's okay. We can love each other while we disagree. You may say, half what you said today I don't think is true. And if the Bible says that, then I don't like the Bible anymore. That's okay. But you listened and you heard. And I want you to understand this, that where Shoreline stands on this as a church is where the church has stood for 2,000 years, where churches stand all around the world today. This is not freakish or strange or weird. This is just what the Bible teaches and God's call in our lives. And God wants what is best for us. He invented sexuality. He invented male and female. He said, be fruitful and multiply. He designed us this way. He's given boundaries. And within those boundaries, it is an amazing, amazing gift. And outside those boundaries, God says, don't walk outside those boundaries because it damages your life. It's not what I have designed for you. My hope and my prayer is that this will be a church where we continue to talk and think and agree and disagree, but love each other along the way. Amen? Amen? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for Shoreline Community Church. We thank you for your word that is true, that gives boundaries and clarity and doesn't change in a world where things seem to change by the week or by the hour. God, your word doesn't change. We thank you, God, that we can be compassionate and loving and caring and yet still hold to the truth and your word. And I pray that Shoreline Church would be a place where people grappling with any and every sin would know that they are welcome because, Jesus, you gave your life for us in the midst of our sins, and you have more good plan for us than we can imagine or dream. For those who are struggling, hurting, broken in this area of their lives and really, really dealing with deep pain or walking with loved ones who are dealing with deep pain. Bring your comfort and your strength and your presence and your care. When there's areas of our life that feel like we can't overcome, that the natural desire is so strong and the inclination is so deep, may we look to your supernatural power. You, Jesus, who also dwell in us and who are one with us. Give us power to follow you, even in ways beyond what we could imagine or dream. And lead us to the beauty and the grace and the joy of intimacy with you. And out of that, great intimacy with others in a way that honors you. We pray this in your name, Jesus, and for your glory. Amen. I want to hand our venues off to their venue pastors. They'll share a few words with you.